Four Terrifying Tales.
What did your parents read to you as a child? Traditional children's stories are designed to both entertain and teach, but they're also often full of violence, cruelty, and death. Here are four.
The Thumbsucker by Heinrich Hoffmann. The Thumbsucker is a story that appears in Struwelpeter, a collection of 10 illustrated tales by German author Heinrich Hoffmann. It was published in 1845. The story is about a little boy called Conrad who won't stop sucking his thumb. One day, when his mother is out, Conrad pops his thumb into his mouth once again. But this time, a sinister-looking tailor runs in with a giant pair of scissors and cuts off Conrad's thumbs. The moral of the story? Don't suck your thumbs.
Little Red Riding Hood by Charles Perrault. In the earliest written account of this famous story by Charles Perrault, Little Red Riding Hood is in the forest when a wolf appears. Naively, she tells him that she's going to visit her grandmother. The wolf says goodbye, then runs off to the house. He eats the grandmother, puts on her clothes, then jumps into bed to wait for Little Red Riding Hood. Eventually, Little Red Riding Hood gets to the house and is about to be eaten by the wolf when she's rescued by a passing hunter. The moral of the story? Never talk to strangers.
Hansel and Gretel by the Brothers Grimm. Hansel and Gretel are the young children of a poor woodcutter. One day, his second wife takes the children into the woods and leaves them there, as there isn't enough food for everyone in the family. After days of wandering around, the children find a cottage made of gingerbread and sweets. As they're feasting on the goodies, the door opens and a witch appears. She invites them in, then locks Hansel in an iron cage and forces Gretel to become her slave. She wants to fatten up the boy so she can eat him, but Gretel pushes the witch into an open oven where she dies. The moral of the story? Never accept sweets from strangers.
The Little Mermaid by Hans Christian Andersen. A young mermaid falls in love with a prince and wants to marry him. Desperate to change, she visits a sea witch who gives the mermaid legs in return for her voice. The mermaid also learns that she'll die if the prince marries anyone else. Unfortunately, the prince is in love with another woman and decides to wed her. But just before the mermaid is about to die, her sisters bring her a knife. They tell her that if she kills the prince, she can become a mermaid again. But the little mermaid can't bring herself to do it. Eventually, she turns into a spirit and goes into the kingdom of God. The moral of the story? Be careful what you wish for.
And they talk about violence on TV. The things we think it's okay to steal.
Theft is a crime, isn't it? Well, not always. According to a recent survey carried out by paintballing.co.uk, there are some things that people think it's all right to take.
As part of the poll, 1,000 adults were asked what they felt was acceptable to steal without feeling guilty. Top of the list were hotel freebies, such as shampoo, soap, towels, razors, hairbrushes, and bathrobes, with 93% believing that it was all part of staying at the hotel.
Next on the list was unsecured internet, with 88% saying they'd have no qualms about accessing a neighbor's network if it wasn't password protected.
This is followed by restaurant condiments, with 55% feeling that it was perfectly acceptable to walk off with sachets of ketchup and mustard, as they'd already been paid for in the price of the meal.
At work, 27% felt it was okay to take home office stationery, with 22% also thinking there was nothing wrong with helping themselves to a colleague's tea, coffee, or biscuits.
Out shopping, 17% felt it was all right to eat pick-and-mix sweets, as they were going to buy some anyway. 11% saw nothing wrong with taking the odd extra apple at the supermarket fruit counter after weighing their fruit. 10% thought it was okay to weigh expensive food items, such as avocados, as cheaper ones, like tomatoes. And 8% said they wouldn't feel guilty for walking off with pens or pencils from shops such as IKEA, as it was a form of publicity for the company, as the pens had their logos on.
Finally, 3% admitted to having taken home park flowers to decorate the house or to give as gifts to friends or relatives.
What would you take without feeling guilty? Grammar Booster. Improve your speaking by learning these basic structures. The present continuous for future arrangements. Affirmative.
I'm seeing Zoe at 6 p.m.
You're seeing Zoe at 6 p.m.
He's seeing Zoe at 6 p.m.
She's seeing Zoe at 6 p.m.
It's seeing Zoe at 6 p.m.
We're seeing Zoe at 6 p.m.
They're seeing Zoe at 6 p.m.
Negative.
I'm not seeing Zoe at 6 p.m.
You aren't seeing Zoe at 6 p.m.
He isn't seeing Zoe at 6 p.m.
She isn't seeing Zoe at 6 p.m.
It isn't seeing Zoe at 6 p.m.
We aren't seeing Zoe at 6 p.m.
They aren't seeing Zoe at 6 p.m.
Interrogative.
Am I seeing Zoe at 6 p.m?
Are you seeing Zoe at 6 p.m?
Is he seeing Zoe at 6 p.m?
Is she seeing Zoe at 6 p.m?
Is it seeing Zoe at 6 p.m?
Are we seeing Zoe at 6 p.m?
Are they seeing Zoe at 6 p.m?
We can use the present continuous to talk about future arrangements with other people at specific times. For example,
A. I'm seeing Jack at 6 p.m.
B. We're meeting at 11 a.m.
We use this tense for plans that are fixed at a certain time in the future. For example,
A. She's leaving at 9 p.m.
B. Paul and Caitlin are coming to the party this Sunday.
C. We're going skiing next week. Dialogue. Meeting up. Lauren and Alfie are talking about meeting up.
So, what are you doing next Sunday?
Nothing much. Why?
Well, we're having a barbecue if you want to come over.
Sounds good. What time?
About 1 p.m.
Great. Should I bring anything?
Just yourself.
Perfect.
Oh, and I'm meeting up with Jenny and Mike later today if you fancy joining us.
Okay. What time?
7 p.m. in the Fox and Hound. You know, that pub on the corner of Argyle Street.
Yeah, I've been there. I've got a doctor's appointment at 6 p.m, but I should be finished by then.
Great. Oh, and what are you doing next Saturday morning?
I'm not sure. Why?
Well, Ben's moving house. I told him we'd be able to help.
We? But I can't. I've got a dental appointment in the morning. They're taking a tooth out. And then I'm playing tennis with Carl.
Oh, right. Well, you'd better phone Ben to tell him you can't make it. He's counting on you.
Okay, I will.
English in action.
Disasters and emergencies. Dialogue. Lost. Randy and Flynn are in a rock band. While filming their music video in the mountains, they've managed to get lost. Also, Randy has fallen and hurt his leg and arm.
Ow! My arm really hurts. I'll never be able to play the guitar again.
You couldn't play in the first place.
Very funny.
Can you walk?
Let me try. Ah! No, I think my leg is broken.
What a disaster. We'll never finish this video.
It's your fault we got lost. The film crew was right behind us, but you wanted to run ahead to look for a good location.
My fault? It was your idea to shoot the video in the mountains. I wanted to do it in the studio. Much safer.
Call the paramedics.
Paramedics? Are you kidding? An ambulance can't get up here. We need the air sea rescue service. They've got helicopters.
Well, call them. I'm in pain.
Oh, stop exaggerating. Oh no, my phone's dead.
I know. Let's make a fire. We can send smoke signals.
No way. We'll probably start a forest fire.
Then make a stretcher out of some tree branches and carry me down.
Are you crazy? I can't carry you by myself, especially not with all that weight you've put on.
Well, Think of something. I don't want to die in the mountains.
Relax. It's just a sore arm and leg.
Broken arm and leg, actually.
Whatever. Just be thankful we weren't caught up in an avalanche.
Very comforting.
I've got an idea. I'll leave you here with my bottle of water and my jacket as a blanket, and I'll go and look for some help. I should be back in a day or two.
No way. Don't leave me here. There are wolves.
There aren't any wolves.
Please.
Okay, how about I make you a shelter out of branches and leaves, and then I... Wait, what's that?
Wolves?
No, sniffer dogs.
Oh, thank God, I'm saved.
Oh, no, you're right. It's wolves. Quick, run! Run! Run for your life!
Wait!
Is the world about to end?
Asteroid attacks, famine, nuclear disaster. People have been making predictions about the end of the world for centuries. Here are a few of the most famous ones.
One of the earliest prophecies came from Christopher Columbus. He declared that the world would end in 1658. His calculations were based on the fact that the planet was going to last just 7,000 years, and that it had been created in 5342 BC. Of course, that wouldn't be his only major mistake. In 1642, he thought he'd landed in India, when it was actually America.
Herbert W. Armstrong, the founder of the Worldwide Church of God, told his congregation that the world was going to end in 1936, and that only they would be saved. After the prophecy failed, he changed the date three more times before finally giving up.
Jim Jones, the founder of the People's Temple Agricultural Project, claimed he had visions that a nuclear holocaust was going to take place in 1967. Later, on the 18th of November 1978, he convinced his followers to commit mass suicide in northwestern Guyana. Known as the Jonestown Massacre, more than 900 people died from cyanide poisoning. After overseeing the deaths, Jones shot himself in the head.
In 1966, Jehovah's Witnesses declared that 1975 marked 6,000 years since man's creation, and that this would be the end of our existence on Earth. Later, they said it was only a possibility, though some continued to affirm that 1975 would probably be the end.
Hongming Chen, the leader of the Taiwanese cult God's Salvation Church, claimed that God would appear on Channel 18 on every TV set in the US on the 25th of March 1998. Then, at 10 a.m. on the 31st of March, God would come to Earth in a flying saucer. On top of that, God would have the same physical appearance as Chen himself. Chen chose to base his cult in Garland, Texas, because he thought Garland sounded like God's land.
Philip Berg, dean of the Worldwide Kabbalah Center, said that a ball of fire would descend on Earth on the 11th of September, 1999, destroying almost all forms of life.
The world-renowned linguist Charles Berlitz predicted that the world would end in 1999. He didn't specify how, but he said that it could involve nuclear devastation, asteroid impact, pole shift, or other Earth changes.
One of the most recent predictions came from the Mayans, an ancient civilization that ruled over areas of what is now southern Mexico, Guatemala, and Belize between 1000 BC and 1519 AD. According to several interpretations of their calendar, the world was going to end on the 21st of December, 2012. Many people around the world took the warning seriously, and one man even built his very own Noah's Ark.
Beware of false prophets.
Two transport stories. Tram ride.
I often get the tram into town on Saturday morning to do a bit of shopping. There's a busker who's usually at the tram station playing the guitar and singing. He does covers of famous songs by Elvis Presley or the Beatles, and he's quite good, so I sometimes give him a bit of spare change. Anyway, last Tuesday, my boss sent me out to visit a client in an office in the centre. Just as I was going in, I walked past this well-dressed guy in an expensive suit and shiny black shoes. He was talking excitedly to a group of colleagues. I thought I recognised him, but I couldn't quite remember where I knew him from. About an hour later, as I was leaving the building, I saw the same guy again, and it was then that I suddenly remembered who he was, the busker from the tram station. Of course, he didn't look anything like the long-haired guy in scruffy jeans and the dirty old T-shirt that I knew. How strange. Bus trip.
I was on the bus last week, and it was full of people dressed up for a fancy dress party. There were pirates, vampires, ghosts, Vikings, you name it, they were there. Anyway, about 10 minutes into the journey, there was some shouting from the top of the bus. Thief! Thief! Stop! Thief! A woman was screaming desperately. Seconds later, a man came crashing down the stairs with a bag in his hand. Immediately, two of the partygoers jumped up and stood in his path. One was a pirate with an eye patch and a sword, and the other was a Viking with an axe and a helmet with horns. "Hand it over," the pirate said forcefully, with his sword drawn. Incredibly, the man just gave them the bag, then pushed his way past them and jumped off the bus. I guess he felt a bit intimidated. Later, the pirate and Viking gave the bag back to the woman, then calmly sat down again. Weird.
Travel English. At the hotel. Dialogue. Checking in. Melissa has just arrived at the hotel where she's staying. She's at the front desk. Hi, can I help you?
Yes, I made a reservation a couple of weeks ago.
What name did you make it under, please?
Simmons. Melissa Simmons.
Yes. A single room for 2 nights.
Actually, it was a double room for 3 nights.
Oh, I'm sorry about that. I'll just change the booking. Right, so that's a double room for 3 nights.
Yes, I'll be checking out on Monday morning.
Could I have your credit card and passport, please?
Yes, here you are.
Thanks. You're in room 625, which is on the 6th floor. Here's your key card, and the lift is just over there.
Great. What time is the restaurant open for breakfast, please?
Between 7 a.m. and 10 a.m.
Okay. And is there a swimming pool here?
Yes, just down those stairs over there on the right. We've got some pool towels if you need one.
Perfect.
And let me know if there's anything else you need. Enjoy your stay.
Thanks.
Seven superstitions from English-speaking countries.
Are you superstitious? Here are the origins of seven common superstitions from English-speaking countries.
If you break a mirror, you'll have 7 years bad luck. It was an ancient belief that mirrors could capture your soul, so breaking a mirror was like damaging your spirit. The only way to counter the bad luck is to bury the broken pieces in a hole and to cover them up with mud.
If you spill some salt, throw it over your left shoulder or you'll have bad luck. In the past, many people believed that spilling salt could lead to bad luck. The only way to stop this was to throw salt over your left shoulder, which is where they believed the devil was often lurking. The belief was that you could neutralize the bad luck by throwing salt into the devil's eyes.
If a black cat crosses your path, bad luck will follow. During the Middle Ages, people thought black cats were witches in disguise, and a black cat crossing your path was a sign that the devil was watching you.
It's good luck to find a horseshoe in an open field. If you find a horseshoe in an open field, you need to pick it up with your right hand, make a wish, then throw it over your left shoulder. The ancient Greeks considered the horseshoe a symbol of fertility and good fortune.
In England in the Middle Ages, people often hung an upside-down horseshoe on doors to frighten off witches or demons.
Knock on wood to stop bad things from happening. If you're talking about something and you don't want it to happen, you need to knock on a piece of wood and say, touch wood. For example, if you say, I've never had an accident, you need to tap on a piece of wood so you don't actually have an accident yourself. This comes from an ancient belief that good spirits lived in trees. However, when the tree was cut down, the spirits inside would die and evil spirits would take over. By knocking on the wood, you could drive away the evil spirits and prevent any misfortune.
The number 13 will bring you bad luck. In many English-speaking countries, the number 13 is considered unlucky. And Friday the 13th is the day for misfortune. The superstition is so common that some hotels avoid having a 13th floor, and airlines don't give tickets for the 13th row. But why? Apparently, the origins are religious. At Jesus Christ's Last Supper, there were 13 people around the table, including Christ and the 12 apostles. And Friday was the day that Christ was crucified. Fear of the number 13, triskaidekaphobia, is a specifically recognized phobia.
Walking under a ladder will bring you bad luck. The origins of this superstition are also religious. In Christianity, the triangle is a sacred symbol that represents the Holy Trinity of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. A ladder against a building forms the shape of a triangle, so by walking under it, you break the triangle. Of course, apart from that, it also seems logical that if you walk under a ladder, something could fall on your head.
Quirky news. Unusual news stories from around the world.
Prison fun. Have you ever wondered what it's like to go to prison? Now's your chance. A former maximum security jail in Holland has just been turned into a luxury hotel. Het Arresthuis, which is Dutch for the Judgment House, was one of the Netherlands' most notorious prisons. But now its 105 cells have been turned into 40 chic and spacious suites. Each room has free Wi-Fi, a flat-screen TV, and a coffee machine. And the hotel has a gym, sauna, and an organic herb garden. The designers have also kept some parts of the original jailhouse, including the solid metal doors and the bars across the windows. In the evening, the hotel serves special prison dinners, where guests dress up as inmates and eat together at a communal table. One guest wrote on TripAdvisor, "We loved our stay in cell number 9 and would certainly do time there again."
Fun fact, at the Poseidon Resort in the Bahamas, you can sleep in a glass room 13 meters underwater. Honest man. They say honesty is the best policy. It certainly was for Bill Ray Harris, a homeless man from Kansas who lives under a bridge. He spends his days begging by the side of the road. Just recently, local woman Sarah Darling accidentally dropped her engagement ring into his cup while she was giving him some change. Later on, while Bill was counting the day's takings, he found the platinum and diamond ring. "The ring was so big that I knew if it was real, it was expensive," he said. But instead of selling it, he kept it in case Sarah came back. 2 days later, she did, and he returned the ring. "It was a miracle," Sarah said. And now she's set up a page on the internet to raise money for Bill to help him start a new life. So far, over 8,000 people have donated a total of $200,000.
Fun fact. America is officially the most charitable nation in the world, with Ireland in second place and Australia in third, in proportion to their populations.
Music in English.
1980s pop songs.
Mm, Many of the biggest hits from the 1980s are still popular today. Three songs that define the decade are Michael Jackson's Billie Jean, A-ha's Take on Me, and Cyndi Lauper's Time After Time.
Michael Jackson. Michael Jackson's music career began in 1964. Back then, he was only 7 years old and was part of the Jackson 5 with four of his brothers. Later, Michael went solo and became so popular in the 1980s that people started calling him the King of Pop.
Song. Billie Jean was one of the best-selling singles of 1983. It comes from Michael Jackson's second and most successful album, Thriller. The song is about all the female groupies who used to follow Michael around, sometimes claiming that he was the father of their child.
A-ha. A-ha were a Norwegian pop band. Formed in 1982, they released their biggest-selling album, Hunting High and Low, in 1985. The disc went triple platinum. The fact that A-ha sang all their songs in English contributed to their international success. The band's members were lead vocalist Morden Harkett, guitarist Paul Waktar Savoy, and keyboardist Magna Furuholmen.
Song. Take on Me was A-ha's first ever single. It's a love song, but the actual meaning of the lyrics is unclear. The band made an animated music video for the track, and it was played repeatedly on MTV. Many artists have covered the song, including Madonna, Tori Amos, and the Jonas Brothers.
Cyndi Lauper. Cyndi Lauper is an American pop star. She kicked off her career in the 1970s, singing covers in New York clubs. Record executives were impressed by her distinctive singing voice and original fashion sense and signed her up for a record deal. She won the Grammy for Best New Artist in 1985, and she continues performing today.
Song. One Night, Cyndi saw the 1979 science fiction movie Time After Time. She was inspired by the film title and stayed up all night writing a song with the same name. The lyrics are about two people who are in a relationship but who are growing apart. Music critic Scott Flowman called the track one of the decade's finest ballads.
I can't hear what you've said, then you said.
Two customer service stories. Internet provider. I once signed up for a new internet service provider to host my blog and website. They were offering really cheap rates and were going to give me some more space, which I needed. Everything seemed to go quite smoothly, and within a couple of days my website was up and running on the new server. However, about a day after that, I got this call from someone in the sales department asking whether I was interested in video streaming for the site. I politely told them that I was all right for the moment, but if they wanted to send me through the information and price list by email, I'd think about it. The following day, someone from the customer service department called up and asked whether I was happy with the service. I told them I was, and then the day after that, someone else phoned up and asked me to rate the service on a scale of 1 to 10. I said it was a bit early to do that, as I hadn't been with them for long, and could they please stop calling me? Yes, of course, she said. But the following day, someone else called up from another department. In fact, for the next week or so, I got about 10 calls from different people in the company. Eventually, I asked to speak to the managing director and explain the problem. She apologized and promised that I wouldn't receive any more calls, which was great.
Restaurant. The other day, I went out to this restaurant with a friend. It wasn't that busy, and we were in a rush, so we were keen to get seated and served as quickly as possible. We waited a bit, but the waiter didn't come over, so we found a table ourselves. A few minutes later, there was still no sign of the waiter, so I started looking around, trying to catch his eye. But every time I seemed to be about to get his attention, he looked the other way. After another couple of minutes of that, we'd had enough, so we got up to leave. But just as we were about to go out the front door, the manager popped up out of nowhere and asked us what the problem was. We told him what had happened, and he went to get the waiter. Seconds later, there was a full-blown shouting match going on between them. Eventually, the waiter stormed off and the manager came back. I'm really sorry about that. He's a bit temperamental at times. If you stay, we'd be happy to invite you to a free bottle of wine. Okay, we thought, so we went to sit down. A minute or so later, the waiter came over and threw a menu down on our table and mumbled, "I'll be back." It was just incredible how rude he was, but it was also really funny to watch, like something out of a TV sitcom. Anyway, we enjoyed watching the world's rudest waiter, and the food was great. Of course, we never left a tip.
Group talk.
So, guys, I've just seen all these dogs around the city, and I kind of wonder, how can people have dogs in their apartments? Because the apartments here are tiny.
They are really small, yeah. I know for a fact my host mother doesn't have a dog, but her apartment is very small and it could not contain a dog.
Mine too, and most of the apartments here don't even have gardens, so the dogs would just be holed up inside the flat all day with nothing to do.
And then another thing you see is that a lot of people don't curb their dogs, so you end up having a lot of accidents on the ground that end up being accidents later in the office underneath your shoe.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, that's not a great thing to have when you walk into the office first thing in the morning.
No. Part of me thinks that a cat would be better, right?
I think here, cats definitely would be better.
I'd have to disagree with you because I've never been a cat person myself.
Yeah, me neither, but I think here it'd have to be cats.
Yeah, maybe, you know, subjective to where we are, cats would probably be more efficient.
Well, I mean, I've always been a cat person. My parents have always had cats, and I love cats. And I could see myself with a cat here in a big city. But a dog?
Personally, I've never really been a dog person, but here, I think, depending on the country, I think cats could be a winner.
Yeah, okay. Definitely. I'd have to agree with you on that.
Slang conversation. Conversations to help you learn English slang.
The house party. Luke has just arrived at Zoe's house, where there's a party.
Luke, glad you could make it at last.
Thanks for the invite. Nice place you got here.
Cheers. There's a flat on the fourth floor that's up for grabs if you're interested.
Nah, I'm fine where I am, thanks. Rocking party. I could hear it two blocks away.
Yeah, the music is a bit loud. Here, chuck your coat over there and let me get you a drink. A nice cold one?
Perfect. So, what's it like living here?
Not too bad. The neighbours are a bit of a pain, though. The woman in the flat above is a tap dancer, and her son's learning the trumpet. What a racket!
Sounds like you're getting your own back. Do you think they'll come down to complain?
No, they've gone away for the weekend.
Ah, when the cat's away. So, what's your new flatmate like?
His room's a pigsty. He's always leaving his stuff lying around, and he helps himself to my food. But he's fairly easygoing, a good laugh, and he gets me into gigs for free. as he's a band manager.
Oh, that's all right then.
Right, let me introduce you to a few people.
Actually, have you got any grub? I'm starving.
There were some pizzas, but I think someone scoffed them all. Oh, there's a bit of cake left if you want. And I think there are a few crisps in the living room.
Well, I think I'll have some of that cake. Skip lunch.
You must be hungry.
Yeah, tell me about it. So, who are all these friends of yours?
A few old school friends, some mates from work. Oh, and there's this girl I've been meaning to introduce you to, Jessica. I know you two guys will hit it off. I've been telling her all about you.
Hope it was all good.
Of course.
So, what's this I've heard about you and Jack?
Communication problems and language difficulties. Two stories.
Nature. I'm from Norway, and about 10 years ago, I went to live in London for a couple of years to improve my English. Shortly after arriving, I got a job in an estate agent's in the centre of town. On my first day at work, this guy in his 60s came over to my desk and started chatting. He seemed to be quite friendly and told me that he was a naturist. That's great, I said innocently. I'm from Norway and we're really into that too, not fully understanding what I was saying. Perking up, he said that he was having a party that weekend and wanted to know whether I'd like to come along. Keen to meet a few of the locals, I accepted. So, the following Saturday, I headed off to his house. I guess I hadn't really paid much attention to the word naturist, but assumed it meant that he was into nature or something like that. Well, that turned out to be a big mistake. When I got to the house, I was met at the door by a man in a loosely fitting bathrobe. That's weird, I thought. But anyway, I told him who I was and he invited me in. But before stepping in, I peered through the front door and out into the back garden, where I could see a group of people who were chatting and eating and all completely naked. And it was at that point that something clicked and I realised that naturists weren't actually environmentalists, they were nudists. Not wanting to appear rude, I made up a feeble excuse about having left my bag at home and rushed off. It was a bit embarrassing seeing the man at work again, but we just ignored each other after that.
Ballet. I got a job in a lawyer's firm in Hong Kong once. In my first week, I was invited to a welcoming party for the new employees in a bar near to the office. The managing director was there, talking to some of the people from the firm, and I joined in on the conversation. He introduced me to everyone, told them where I'd been working before, and then mentioned something about my wife, saying, "And his wife is a professional dancer." Strange, I thought. Why did he think my wife's a dancer? But not wanting to question him in front of everyone else, I just smiled and tried to change the topic of conversation. Later, someone else mentioned how they'd heard that my wife was a great dancer. By then, I was completely confused because although my wife liked dancing, she's not exactly what I'd call a dancer. Curious to find out what was going on, I asked a colleague why everyone thought my wife was a dancer. "Because you told us that she's a ballet dancer," he replied. "But my wife isn't a ballet dancer," I said. Eventually, we figured out that it was because I'd said that my wife was from Bali, which is in Indonesia, and that one of the managers had understood ballet and had presumed I was saying that she was a ballet dancer when I'd just been trying to tell them where she was from. Anyway, later, this manager had told everyone else about how she was a dancer, and things just went from there. It's incredible how one simple mistake can lead to such confusion. Truth and Lies, how Hollywood films compare to real life.
Hollywood films are often based on real life events. But how close are they to the truth? Here are two movies that were inspired by true stories. 1. The Impossible.
In December 2004, the Alvarez Bellon family were enjoying a holiday at their beachside hotel in Phuket, Thailand, when disaster struck. Early in the morning of the 26th, a 10-meter tsunami crashed into the resort, slamming Maria, the mother, into some nearby trees. After the initial shock, she found her eldest son, Lucas. Sometime later, villagers carried Maria to a hospital in Tacuapa so that medical staff could operate on her life-threatening injuries. Maria's husband and two younger boys were in the swimming pool at the time. Miraculously, they also survived, and the family was reunited a few days later. In total, the wave killed over 200,000 people.
The film version of the event captures the terror and destructive power of the tsunami and was partially filmed at the resort where the family were staying. But despite the similarities, there's one major difference. While the real-life Alvarez Belon family are Spanish, the family portrayed in the movie are British. In the film, Maria and Kike are played respectively by British actors Naomi Watts and Ewan McGregor, with Enrique's name becoming Henry and the family's surname changed to Bennett. Director Juan Antonio Bayona, who is actually Spanish, explained that they needed international actors in order to raise funds for the film. He added, "This is not a film of nationality, race, or social class. All that was swept away by the wave." 2. Argo.
On the 4th of November, 1979, radical Iranian militants took more than 60 hostages from the United States Embassy in Tehran, Iran. 6 US diplomats managed to evade capture and were sheltered by Canadian ambassadors Ken Taylor and John Sheardown. With little chance of escape, Canadian and United States officials needed a plan to get them out. CIA operative Tony Mendez eventually came up with an idea. The 6 would pretend to be Canadian citizens working on a Hollywood film. Canadian ambassador Ken Taylor said, "We thought the plan was okay, but we didn't think we really needed something that intricate." They had some other more straightforward schemes, but ultimately went with the Mendez plan. On the 28th of January 1980, the diplomats passed themselves off as Canadian film crew and left Iran safely. The remaining hostages weren't released until a year later, on the 21st of January 1981.
So, how does the film compare to reality? In the film version, CIA operative Tony Mendez is presented as the hero, while the Canadians take a back seat, only providing housing for the diplomats. Director Ben Affleck said that this was to provide greater dramatic tension by making it seem as if everything was resting on Mendez's shoulders. On top of that, British diplomats are shown refusing to help the Americans, something which is hotly disputed by those who were actually there at the time. Defending the film, Affleck explained, "Because we say it's based on a true story, rather than this is a true story, we're allowed to take some dramatic license."
The late singer-songwriter John Lennon once said, "Reality leaves a lot to the imagination." It's clear that the directors of The Impossible and Argo felt this way too.
Story time.
Jokes, anecdotes, and stories as told by native English speakers.
Lazy birds.
I say. Why do birds fly south for the winter?
I don't know. Why do birds fly south for the winter?
Because it's too far to walk.
Tiger fun.
A police officer is patrolling the streets when he sees a man with a tiger on a lead. He stops the man, takes down his details, and orders him to take the tiger to the zoo. The next day, the police officer sees the same man with the tiger again. "I thought I told you to take the tiger to the zoo," the police officer says. "I did," says the man, "and now I'm taking him to the cinema."
Annoying parrot. A man is on his way to work when he notices a parrot on a perch in the front window of a pet shop. Stopping to have a look, the parrot suddenly says, "Hey, mister, you're really stupid." The man shakes his head and walks off. On the way home, the same thing happens. This continues for a couple of days. Eventually, the man has had enough and goes into the shop. "Could you tell your parrot to stop insulting me, please?" he asks the store owner.
Oh, I'm sorry, says the owner. I'll have a word with him about it. Thanks, says the man. I'd appreciate it. The next day, the man walks past the shop again. Hey, mister, the parrot calls out. Yes, the man asks, wondering what the parrot's going to do. And the parrot says, you know what you are.